Okay, hi. Welcome to One People, One World. My name is Rabbi Yaakov Cohen. I'm here with two very special Levim, Tzadik HaLevi, Achmi HaLevi. Achmi HaLevi, please start off and tell us about yourself and so on. Please, Achmi.
I came to Yiddishkeit at 17, 18 years old. I started off with Sfardim, and my father, Zacharin Livracha, sent me to Hadar Torah in the summer.
What year was this?
This was in the English year 77.
77, okay.
The Jewish year 37.
Okay.
And I learned for a few weeks in Hadar Torah, and I became connected to Chabad at that point. Went back to college. While I was there, I was able to get a number of people to put mezuzahs up. I ran siddurim for 100 plus people on Pesach. I built a sukkah behind our dorm.
Which college is this?
Cornell University.
Cornell University. And you are a master programmer. Is that
I've been a programmer since I'm 15.
Okay.
I worked on the internet when it was called the ARPANET. So I have a history with programming and computers.
Okay. And now we have Tzadik HaLevi. Tzadik, just a bit about your name and about yourself. Please introduce yourself.
Where to begin? I don't know how.
No, keep it a minute. You have 1 minute. We're keeping this very
brief. I was involved in Yiddishkeit at Lincoln Square Synagogue at 200 Amsterdam Avenue. Then I came to Chabad and got more involved with Chabad. And I became more involved with the outreach of Chabad. And also Lincoln Square Synagogue and koshering ovens. And rabbis made the people kosher, and I made the kitchen kosher.
Very nice. Okay, let's talk about your involvement, being that we're coming up to Lag BaOmer, the Rashbi, Rav Shimon Bar Yochai, and it's coming up to Matan Torah, Shavuos. Let's talk about Rashbi. We'll talk about your experiences with Rebbe, and we'll start off with Rachmiel. Tell us a story about you and the Rebbe. You have some very interesting stories, and then we'll go to Tzadik HaLevi. We have two Levim over here.
I'll tell you one interesting story.
But keep it brief.
I was a shliach in Lakewood, New Jersey,
right,
for over 20 years.
Right.
And I would make a bonfire by my house every year. Mm-hmm. And we would have all of the local boys and families would come. For Shem, we were able to bring them in. We were able to teach them.
Okay, and tell us a bit about your history, your story with the Rebbe, Lubavitch Rebbe. You've been here since 1973 in Crown Heights, I'm sure you've...
I've been, yeah.
And Charlie, we're going to give Charlie in a minute, so let's keep it quick, please.
Yeah.
Brief.
I had many interactions. I worked for many years on different projects the Rebbe Shvita had given me. I worked on Chabad.org for a while.
Not something that's not too personal. That's something that you could. Obviously, this is going to be aired on live on, not okay. Live, but it'll be aired throughout Manhattan. But go ahead, please tell us.
Okay,
give the audience a bit of a taste of what.
A taste of who the Rebbe is.
Right.
I mean, you talk about Rashbi, so we know in every generation we have someone who's a Moshe Rabbeinu. Mm-hmm. We had Moshe Rabbeinu. We had Yoshua. We had David HaMelech, we had the Rashbi, and today we have the Rebbe Shvita. So you have a question, you have to ask. So we're setting up Chabad.org, and you have a question. There's a lot of other from organizations.
This is what year?
This was in the early 80s, the early Gomets.
The Lamids?
The Mems.
Mems,
the
okay.
Mems.
So the early 80s, okay.
We're setting up.
And this is with Rabbi Olashom,
Rav Kazin.
Yosef Yitzchak Kazin, which right. You mentioned his name. He was one of the founders.
He was the founder of Chabad.org.
Okay.
And the Reb, knowing that I had experience with the web, I had experience with the internet, asked me to do some programming.
The Rebbe asked you,
To
work with Yosef Kazin.
Yeah. Rabbi so... Because of my knowledge of the net, a lot of times when there was a technical question, it was easier for me to ask than for the other people. So the question became, there are a lot of other websites, a lot of other Jewish organizations that wanted to come up on the net, and nobody knew how back then. So they would all get in touch with Chabad.org. We asked the rabbi what we should do. Should we help them, not help them? So the Rabbi Shkita told us we should help them, but we should never have our name connected in any way to any other site, because it might drive people away, and the Rebbe was more interested in people learning Torah than in getting his name or Chabad's name in lights. And there was a beautiful thing about the Rebbe. He was never looking
for
approbation or for his knowledge or for what.
Recognition.
He just wanted recognition. He just wanted Yidden to learn Torah. And we asked him, should we connect our site to other sites?
Right.
Right? Back then, you had the beginnings of HTML. You had the beginnings of a link. So should we link to H.com? Should we link to other Torah sites? So that he doesn't want that at some point somebody's going to click on a link and go to some other website, and three links later they're going to be looking at Shtus or worse. And we were absolutely flabbergasted. The idea of anybody putting something up that was not proper was beyond us. But the Rebbe already saw, unfortunately, what the world was going to do with it. One personal story. Mm-hmm. I lost my vision when I was 20 years old. And I got my vision back somewhat shortly afterwards, never really knowing what had happened. Years later, the Rebbe Shvit told me my father had been to him to ask for a bracha for my eyesight. And that's how it came back. So I, Baruch Hashem, have some experience with Nisim that the Rebbe was involved with.
Okay, and Charlie, whenever Charlie would go by the Rebbe, especially in Kosher Bracha, the Rebbe would make with his hand, it would be strongly, put sometimes we'd even put down the cup, and tell us what merit you have that you had such a close connection or close with the Rebbe. Tell us something.
I'm not sure it was such a close connection.
I mean, not connection.
All I know is I would say merry is happiness with strong drink.
Okay.
The Rebbe
okay.
said be merry.
And be simple.
And we go to weddings,
okay.
Then it was weddings, then engagements and bar mitzvahs, and each wedding, engagements and bar mitzvah, I would say my speech,
right.
And became
very, very nice. Okay, I see your chmiel over here. Levi is wearing a button. It says June 17th, Talmud celebration, and I know Charlie's been the man behind the force. June 17th. So just tell us in about a minute or two what you have to say about June 17th.
June 17th.
And why it's Talmud celebration.
Talmud was burnt.
Where?
Destroyed in Paris.
Right.
It was Pashas Chukat. This year it'll be 770 years ago.
Right.
From the ashes of the Talmud rose the Talmud like the phoenix. And today the Talmud was learned around the world and in many languages.
So June 17th we celebrate?
June 17th is the day of Talmud celebration.
Where we
now, because of that, because when they burnt the Talmud, it was just a few Jewish people who lived in Europe, in Paris, they got away with it. But today, it's the land, it's the people, the land, the nation, and the army of Israel. And very few people would try to do something so outrageous as to burn the Talmud.
Well, the Talmud is kept the Jewish people, and the halacha is alive for the last
2,000 years.
And it's interesting that they tried to burn it 770 years ago.
Then several times.
Which 770 is actually a complete number. It's explained, you know, seven represents the seven emotions that we have to refine in Golus. And 7 times 7 is 7 is 70, and then 770 is actually the number.
7 times 7 is 49.
No, 7 times, yeah, but I'm talking about the seven midos as they're connected to the 10 midos, which is really 70. because we have, like, we're counting the Sefirot HaOmer, it's 49, right. but anyways, so 770 is a very special day, special number.
Uferasa.
Uferasa, it also means Uferasa. It also
Beis
means
Mashiach.
And also Beis Mashiach, it means France. France is Tzarfas, is also 770. So 770 years ago, they tried to burn the Talmud, and thank God we're here learning, studying the Talmud. And June 17th, this year or every year, we shall celebrate. Charlie, what do you have in mind for our viewers out there? What should they do in terms of celebration? Number one, they should study the Talmud.
Study Talmud.
Make a Siyum. A Siyum is
a Siyum.
A Siyum is a completion tractate.
Yes. But if there's a wedding, an engagement, or a bar mitzvah, they should incorporate that as a part of their
Siyum mitzvah. Okay.
They should incorporate that wedding engagement part as part of a Talmud celebration. Okay.
And what else should we do? We should study Talmud.
We study Talmud every day.
Every day.
But on June 17th, it's a special occasion because they try to destroy us, destroy the Talmud, and today the Talmud is greater than ever, learned around the world in many languages.
Okay. Baruch Hashem.
And we should give it special recognition. And by publicizing it, we're telling the nations of the world, the Jewish nation is alive, well, and stronger than ever, and soon the days of Mashiach will be here.
Tell us about Mashiach. Let's talk about Mashiach for a moment. Rachmiel, he just switched the topic to Mashiach. Go ahead, tell us what Mashiach is going to be like. Let's talk about, it's going to be a time when there's no...
It's going to be a time when there's no war.
Right.
It's going to be a time when we're living as the Torah wants us to live. Mm-hmm. And even the rest of the world will be living in a peaceful state. Everyone will have their, in terms of things, there'll be plentiful food, there'll be plentiful housing, there won't be fighting, there won't be competition. We'll be able to live in the way we lived in the Garden of Eden.
Okay, and most importantly, we'll be able to serve together in the Beis HaMikdash.
Yes, the Leviim and the Kohanim
the
will
third
be
temple,
serving.
Me as a Kohen, you two as a lady.
As Leviim.
We will be at your service for both all people to come out and to pay pilgrimage to Hashem. Go ahead, tell us about the third temple.
In the third temple, the entire world literally will come and bring korbanos. They'll bring animals, they'll bring things to thank Hashem for the world. They'll be able to come to bring obviously there won't be sin anymore in the times of the Beis HaMikdash, so there won't, after the Beis HaMikdash is established, and everyone has their chance to bring their sin offerings and their offerings for potential sins, it'll be a time of everybody just bringing Thanksgiving offerings, just for the privilege of living in the world. People are going to just want to thank Hashem.
And let's talk about where it's going to be. It's actually going to be in the Holy Land of Israel, in Jerusalem.
Yes,
Yerushalayim Yidah Kodesh. And we're going to switch to Charlie now. What Israel represents? Israel is the heart. The Jewish people are the heart of the world. And Israel
the Messiah will come through the Jewish people.
Okay, right. And what's the land of Israel? What we're talking about now, the land of Israel. What is the land Israel represents? Just like, let me just preface our viewers, in the times of the Second Temple, which was close to 2,000 years ago, the temple stood as a beacon of light for all to see. It was a light, the Jewish people are to be a light unto nations, meaning we are to be a guide in with Torah and mitzvahs, and the temple was a place where that light shine forth. From Zion shall go forth the Torah from Jerusalem. Let's talk about the holy city of Jerusalem. Charlie, what does Jerusalem or Israel represent? What should Israel? Let's, number one, we'll show our viewers. This is a picture of the Western Wall, which the Second Temple stood. And here's a Jewish person praying at the Western Wall. And this is, we're going to see the same, very same spot. There will be the third temple, please God, today. And we'll see the third temple where everyone, like Rachmiel Halevi said, will pay pilgrimage. So what does Israel represent? Israel represents a time, yeah? Israel represents a time and a place, a very special place in the earth, where we connect. It's a local call. The joke is that, you know, from around the world, it's a long-distance call. From Israel, it's a local call. But you know, go ahead, Charlie. What is what is Israel? What should Israel be doing to bring peace in Israel and bring peace around the world? Number one, the land of Israel. Israel should not be given up.
The land of Israel should not be given up. It says from the river of Egypt,
right,
the Nile,
right,
to the river Euphrates.
Euphrates, right.
Right. From the Mediterranean Sea in the north to the Indian Sea in the south.
Right.
The Holy Land of Israel. It says so in Scripture.
Right.
And this is what the whole world should know. And it's also the Jews, the government of Israel, who wants to give up land for peace, should know that land for peace does not work out.
Right.
Land for peace is like asking for war.
Right.
Because if we give a little land, they'll want a little more. And that is not peace.
It's pieces.
Pieces.
Piece by piece.
It's interesting, the word peace comes from the word pieces. We cut up, I have an apple, we all want it, we cut it into three pieces. Whereas the word peace in Hebrew means shalom. Shalem comes from the word complete.
Yeah.
There's a completeness over here. You have to have shlemus haaretz, which means complete land, shlemus ha'am, complete people, and Shlemus HaTorah, complete Torah. There can't be any
pieces.
We can't modify the Torah or the Jewish people or the land of Israel, because that is a godly given. Only about peace. So how do we achieve peace? By doing Torah and mitzvahs. And Achmiel, please tell us a little about how do we achieve peace in Israel.
Okay. The way to achieve peace,
yeah,
is by following the Torah that Hashem gave us. Mm-hmm. We don't yet have the temple in Eitz Hashem. Before the end of this broadcast, we're going to hear the shofar blowing to announce the Beis Hamikdash is there.
Right.
And that the Rebbe Melech Mashiach is taking us out of Galus into Yerushalayim.
So wait, let's talk about that. What does that mean, Torah? So
what does it mean, Torah?
Explain to our viewers. The Jewish people have how many commandments?
Have 613 commandments that were given at Har Sinai.
Right, which is coming up.
Which Shavuos, is coming up
Shavuos, the holiday of
2.5-3 weeks.
Right. And
non-Jewish people have 7 laws that were given to them. 6 of them were given to Adam or Yishayim when they left the Garden of Eden. And the 7th one was given to Noah not to eat the limb of a living animal.
Right. Because they are known as the 7 laws.
The 7 laws of Noah, okay, because the 7th one came to Noah.
Right. Okay, so now, if Jews and non-Jews keep this...
If each of us would keep the laws we're supposed to keep, right, obviously, there's certain laws that are for certain people.
Mm-hmm.
For example, you're a Kohen.
Right.
So there's laws that only a Kohen keeps.
Right.
Tzaddik and I are Leviim.
Right.
So there's laws that only a Levi keeps. There's laws for someone who's not a Levi and not a Kohen. There's laws that are just for women. There's laws that are just for men. There's laws that are for somebody who's married. There's laws for somebody who's not married.
There's laws for Jewish people.
There's laws for Jewish people dealing with Jewish people. There's laws for non-Jewish people people. There are laws for every possible conceivable situation. There's laws for every kind of a business situation. There's laws for every kind of a agricultural situation. It's amazing when we learn the Gemara, like Tzadik was speaking before about June 17th, the Gemara brings down the Torah to a way that we can understand how to follow the law.
And the Torah is actually a guidebook. It's actually a way to protect and to teach us.
Right. To teach us
how to conduct
our lives. Right. Right. In terms of interpersonal things. It's not only a law of how I treat God, but it's also a law of how I treat a person. Right. I'm not allowed, for example... Let's say 2 people have a fight, you know, they have a disagreement. So one of them can't go to another person and say a not good thing about the other person.
Right.
There's all kinds of laws about not speaking.
That's called Lashon Hara.
Lashon Hara. We're not about to, we should only speak Lashon Tov. The Rebbe, the Rebbe Shlita always says we should always focus on Tov, on good.
Positive.
I'm positive.
That, Charlie? You agree with that, right?
Well, Talmud celebration.
Right, we agree with only speaking correct.
When I say Talmud celebration, in fact, it's speaking of what is in the Gemara.
The Gemara says, everything straight in the Gemara. And so what else? What else should we be doing?
Okay, what else should we be doing?
Okay.
We should be striving, not only that we should understand the Torah, and we should help the Jewish people, should help other Jewish people who don't yet follow the Torah to follow it, but we should also, the Rambam says, that part of the job given to the Jewish people at Mount Sinai, 3,340 years ago, was that we're to go out and teach the non-Jews how to follow the laws that were given to them. Mm-hmm. And that they should also keep those laws, and they should follow them. And if everyone would follow the laws, as God gave us the laws, it would be a tremendous time of shalom, of peace, and it would, in a sense, automatically lead to the coming of Mashiach.
And that will bring automatically...
And that will bring the entire world into a state of peace.
And also that will bring peace in Israel.
Yes.
Because one of the things that Israel is not allowed to do, or Jewish, they're not allowed to steal, so when non-Jewish people take the land of Israel, whether it's by force or by agreement, that is a direct violation of thou shalt not steal. So we have to realize that thou shalt not steal applies to non-Jewish people, and applies to Jewish people as well, and it means also the land of Israel.
Right. The land of Israel doesn't belong to any person.
It's a godly
gift. It's a godly gift to all of the Jewish people.
To act as a trustee.
To hold. So we don't have the right. Just like if someone would give me a very expensive diamond and say, I'm hiring you to watch it, and I'm going to pay you every day to watch this diamond. Mm-hmm. I can't, 2 weeks after he gives it to me, say, hey, this is an expensive diamond. I'm going to sell it to my friend David.
Right.
And, he'll give me $1 million for it, and I'll go out and have, a good time.
Right.
We're not allowed to do that.
But what you said is that we should teach the non-Jews about the Talmud.
About the Talmud.
About the laws.
Only the Talmud. The person.
They should learn.
Only
I was
certain
the other
parts,
day,
parts.
And I met the players from the East Side Middle School.
Right.
And I suggested to them that they should learn Talmud in preparation for June 17th.
Right.
And I hope they do that.
Okay, that's a good thing. But not every certain laws do not apply to non-Jews. For instance, the Sabbath, Gemara Shabbos, doesn't apply. They shouldn't keep the Sabbath. But there's certain laws. There are many laws which they could, and a lot of tractates they could study. But Rachmiel, continue. So you're saying that this is a way to achieve peace?
It's a way to achieve peace between individual people, between individual groups of people.
And like Charlie was saying, Israel should not be negotiating land for peace.
Right, because it's not ours to negotiate.
Right.
We're a watchman for Israel, but it's not ours to negotiate to give away.
I want you to give you a little speech for about a minute, just a brief speech every time. Just for a minute, only a minute.
You hear the name Marina Rabbeinu Malcolm Shelved. You hear the name Marina Rabbeinu Malcolm Shelved. You hear the name Marina Rabbeinu Malcolm Shelved. Lubavitcher Rebbe is the Messiah of this generation. Lubavitcher Rebbe is the Messiah of all generations. Let the word of the Messiah go forth to all the nations, that Israel is one land, one people, one Torah. It shall not be divided by the presence of the United States or the politicians in Israel, as it is being done piece by piece by piece. There shall be no peace until Israel is one, as it says in Torah, from river to river, from sea to sea, from the river of Egypt to the river Euphrates. And then the Messiah shall be revealed.
Okay, that's it. Okay, Rachmiel, so have you been to Israel?
I haven't been in this Gilgul.
Right.
Because when one goes to Israel, it's Aliyah, it's going up.
Right.
When one, God forbid, has to leave Israel, it's Yerida, going down.
Okay.
And the Rebbe teaches us to only think Tayiv, so I only want to do good. Okay. I only want to move up.
Okay. The Rebbe also never went to
Israel. The Rebbe also never went to Israel for the same reason. The Rebbe said, once one goes, it's a problem unless there's a reason he has to leave.
Right. And any other stories?
I went to Israel.
Okay. Very nice. And what about any other stories you'd like to share with us about your personal, Rachmiel, with the Rebbe?
I once was told by a doctor, there are three different things that are possible things for me to try. And I went, there's certain times the Rebbe would allow you to ask questions. So I asked the Rebbe directly which one of these three things I should do. And the Rebbe said, what question do you want to ask me? And I didn't understand what the Rebbe was saying. So I said, the doctor told me three things, which should I do? And the Rebbe again said to me, what question do you want to ask me? And finally, after three or four times, the Rebbe said, if you would come to me this time and asked me for a refuah, for a complete cure, you could have been rid of the entire disease. So there are times we see that we are given special merits, special abilities. And now, just like at that time I had the ability to do something that I hopefully will have the ability to do again, we're in a special time now. The Rebbe told us it's the Zaman of Mashiach. We're in a time now where every single move we make, not that it's always been important, but now it's super important. Now, one tiny little act of goodness and kindness could literally change the entire face of the world. So I would beg everyone watching this show and to speak to any of your friends and any of your relatives, anybody you work with, to get them to do just one more thing of good. If you see, you know, a person who's poor, to help them to find food, to help them to find whatever they need. If you know a person with a medical situation, to help them maybe to get to a doctor, to help them to get a better cure. If you see somebody who's trying to learn Torah, or if you yourself are trying to learn Torah, so make it a thing that you're going to spend an extra 10 minutes a week. I'm not asking for an hour a day even. 10 minutes, 20 minutes a week to add on to whatever you're doing to do more good. And you should do good in action. Take 10 minutes, 20 minutes a week to do another good action that you wouldn't normally do. Take 10 to 20 minutes to learn something more than you're normally learning. And another 10 to 20 minutes to speak to people and to teach them about doing good things.
Thank you. You know, that's a very, very powerful message and practical message.
So that's for a blessing?
You know why?
Shlomo Betzalel Jacobson.
Yeah.
For his eyes.
Okay. And I just want to say that what he was mentioning also is a very practical application that we should even do it in the schus of Betzalel Jacobson. You should do an extra mitzvah, and also charity doesn't mean just physical charity, it means also being kind to someone else and doing the right thing. And as the Rambam, Maimonides explains that one action, one good deed, one good thought, one good action could actually tip the world in favor and bring about the messianic times that we all want and yearn for so much, and we need it. We want to see that third temple. We want to serve. We are ready on deck for many years, waiting to serve the Levim, the Kohanim, Kohen, Levi. We're ready to serve.
We're ready to work.
We're unemployed over here in America.
That's right.
We want to be employed again.
How many times do you see people who are begging for their work to start?
Right. We want to work. We have our sleeves rolled up. We're ready to work in the Beis Hamikdash. We're there. We're going to be ready at your service. Tzadik HaLevi, Rachmi HaLevi.
This is the house of Levi.
The house of Levi's. Levi's, and we all come from the same tribe, you know, of Aaron HaKohen, which is a person who ran after Shalom. He was a person who pursued peace. When he passed away, the Jewish people mourned a very, very long time because he was a man that pursued peace. And he always tried to bring people together. Chesed. Which kindness, and this is what it's about. Ish Chesed, Kohen Ish Chesed, Levim. We all come from the same great grandfather, and you know he gave us. He set us a good example. He set the standard.
He set the standard high. So, and with Hashem's help, we'll meet that standard.
And you people out there, everyone out there has the ability to act and to behave like Moshe and Aaron. And David HaMelech Siotzed is coming with the Baal Shem Tov's birthday. We have a lot of special days coming up on Shavuos. And we eat the cheesecake, right? Because the cheesecake, because they didn't have kosher. So they had to thank my two guests, my two Levim, for your wonderful words of wisdom and your words of encouragement and words of direction and inspiration, etc., etc. And I want to thank, first of all, Tzadik HaLevi and our Rachmiel HaLevi. And we should only merit to see the goodness and the Mashiach now. We want Mashiach now.
Yechi Adonainu Moneinu Rabbeinu Melech HaMashiach Yeron Ba'ed.
And Yechi, okay, we should have the Gula Mitzvah Shlema. And thank you very much for watching. Shalom. From